High-speed railways have transformed transportation worldwide, and East Asia is at the forefront of this revolution. We've already covered the HSR systems in China, South Korea, and Japan. Now it's time to turn our attention to Taiwan's high-speed rail system, which has reshaped travel across the island, making it faster, more efficient, and incredibly convenient for millions of passengers. As we explore this topic, we'll set aside political debates to focus on what truly matters, the remarkable impact and success of Taiwan's HSR system. But just how successful has it been? Let's dive into the numbers and see the impressive statistics that highlight its impact on passenger transport. As you can see on the screen, during 2023, Taiwan's HSR system transported over 70 million passengers. That's approximately 200,000 passengers each day, served by 151 daily trains. Remarkably, the system has maintained a punctuality rate of over 99% throughout its years of operation, with delays of no more than 5 minutes on the 350-kilometer journey, with travel times of just 1 hour and 45 minutes. But before we delve deeper into the current success, let's go back to the beginning and tell the story of this system, one that, despite its apparent success, has faced its own unique challenges. Although Taiwan's high-speed rail officially began operations in 2007, the idea of creating a new high-speed line dates back to the 1970s, during a period of rapid economic growth known as the Taiwan Miracle. This economic boom led to severe congestion on highways, conventional rail, and air traffic systems along the Western Transport Corridor, threatening to slow down the region's development. In response, the Taiwanese government initiated a feasibility study for HSR construction in 1987, which was completed in 1990. The study revealed that a high-speed rail line would be the most effective solution, offering the highest transit capacity, lowest land use, significant energy savings, and minimal pollution. By the early 1990s, the government approved a plan to move forward with the project, selecting a route that would span the western part of the island. This 350 kilometers line, running from Nangang to Zuoying, would serve almost 90% of Taiwan's population, which is nearly 20 million people. In November 1994, Taiwan passed legislation to encourage private financing for infrastructure projects, which included the high-speed rail project. As a result, in October 1996, the government launched a tender for the project under a Build Operate Transfer, BOT, scheme. The bidding process saw two major contenders, the Taiwan HSR Consortium and the Chunghwa HSR Consortium. Taiwan HSR Consortium proposed using Eurotrain technology, a consortium between Alstom, the manufacturer of the French TGV, and Siemens, the producer of the German ICE. On the other hand, Chunghwa HSR Consortium's bid was based on Japanese Shinkansen technology provided by the Taiwan Shinkansen Consortium, a joint venture of Japanese companies. In September 1997, Taiwan HSR Consortium offered the lower bid and promised to complete the project at zero net cost to the government, and thus it was selected as the preferred bidder. The group was formally established as the Taiwan HSR Corporation in May 1998, and the BOT agreement for a period of 35 years was signed with the government in July 1998. However, the project faced controversy during the rolling stock selection. In 1999, as Taiwan HSR Corporation struggled to secure funding, Japanese government saw a new opportunity in this situation and offered favorable loans to the Taiwan HSR Corporation with the condition that they choose Shinkansen technology. Despite Eurotrain's efforts to match the financial offer and following the Ashade train disaster, Taiwan HSR Corporation ultimately chose the newer 700 series Shinkansen as the preferred rolling stock in December 1999. It's important to note that Taiwan HSR Corporation maintained its commitment to European specifications, which meant the Shinkansen trains had to be specially designed and commissioned according to these standards. Eurotrain did not accept this decision easily and filed a claim for $800 million in damages. After a lengthy arbitration process, Taiwan HSR Corporation agreed to pay $89 million in compensation to Eurotrain in 2004. The construction of the Taiwan High-Speed Rail Line began in May 1999. Designed for speeds of up to 350 kilometers per hour, nearly the entire 350 kilometers route is built on ballastless track, with just a short 3 kilometer section as an exception. The railway line is electrified with a 25 kilovolts at 60 hertz AC system, and the signaling and train control systems are configured for bi-directional operation according to European specifications. Given that Taiwan is frequently hit by natural disasters such as typhoons, earthquakes, heavy rainfall, floods, and landslides, a top priority in the design of the Taiwan high-speed rail system was ensuring passenger safety and the ability to respond effectively to emergencies, particularly earthquakes. To address these challenges, Taiwan HSR Corporation implemented the Disaster Warning System, DWS, a network of sensors installed along the rail route. This system is designed to detect unexpected events, including earthquakes, strong winds, heavy rainfall, floods, landslides, and intrusions. When such an event is detected, the DWS immediately sends signals to the Operation Control Center, which then activates contingency measures to ensure the safety of passengers and trains. These measures can include decelerating or stopping trains in the affected area. Since its introduction in 2007, the DWS has proven to be highly effective. For instance, on March 4, 2010, a 6.4 magnitude earthquake struck southern Taiwan, with its epicenter just 17 kilometers from Kaohsiung. Despite the earthquake causing one train to slightly derail in Tainan and temporarily halting six others, there were no casualties or significant damage. A significant portion of the line, around 251 kilometers, or 73%, is elevated on viaducts. The most notable of these is the Changhua Kaohsiung Viaduct, which stretches 157 kilometers and was the second longest bridge in the world as of 2017. These viaducts are designed to be earthquake resistant, allowing trains to stop safely during seismic events and ensuring that any damage is repairable. Bridges built over known fault lines are engineered to withstand fault movements without catastrophic damage. Additionally, about 61 kilometers, or 18% of the line, runs through tunnels, including the 14-kilometer Trupo section in Taipei, and 48 other tunnels with a combined length of 46.3 kilometers along the route. The route includes 12 stations, with most intermediate stations located outside the cities they serve. However, various transfer options, such as free shuttle buses, conventional rail, and metro systems, have been established to ensure seamless transport connections. Major civil engineering works were completed by 2004, and the first delivery of the 700T Shinkansen trains followed shortly thereafter. These trains are based primarily on the 700 series Shinkansen that currently operates on the Sanyo Shinkansen line and previously on the Tokaido Shinkansen line in Japan, with the T referring to Taiwan. But as we've highlighted, the Shinkansen 700T had to be specially designed to meet the European specifications adopted by Taiwan HSR Corporation. Due to these stringent safety requirements, the trains were equipped with several additional safety features compared to their Japanese counterparts. The digital automatic train control system, enhanced with cruise control, station stopping control and driver vigilance device, was deployed in Shinkansen 700T. This system was derived from that of the 800 series Shinkansen. Bogies were fitted with an instability detection system and pantographs with a system that automatically lowers the rear pantograph if it detects a failure of the leading pantograph. The trains were built with shock-absorbing elements for protection in low-speed collisions and were equipped with a parking brake. Additionally, the tunnels along the line were built according to European standards, with larger diameters than those in Japan. The nose of the trains was aerodynamically optimized for these different tunnel cross-sections, resulting in a shorter 8-meter-long nose. The shorter nose, along with the absence of a sliding window and an extra door for the driver, provided more space for passengers. The maximum service speed of the trains was increased from the original 285 kilometers per hour, which was the speed of the Shinkansen 700 series, to a speed of 300 kilometers per hour for operation in Taiwan. The 12 cars of a 700T train are grouped into three traction units, each with three power cars and one trailer, spanning a total length of 304 meters and accommodating up to 989 passengers. Running tests on the high-speed line began in January 2005 on the Tainan-Kaohsiung section. During these tests, a national speed record of 315 kilometers per hour was achieved in October of the same year. All 30 trains were delivered to Taiwan by 2006, and commercial operation of the 700T began on January 5, 2007, at a maximum operating speed of 300 kilometers per hour. The construction of Taiwan's high-speed rail system was initially estimated to cost around approximately USD 15 billion at the time. However, due to various delays, technological changes, and unforeseen expenses, the final cost escalated to around USD 18 billion. This figure includes the costs of building infrastructure, stations, and procuring rolling stock. Despite reaching its 10 millionth passenger just 265 days after operations began and maintaining a punctuality rate of over 99%, Taiwan HSR Corporation has faced significant financial challenges. The traffic forecasts were overly optimistic during the bidding process, with the company needing more than 140,000 passengers per day to break even. However, in the early years, it only averaged around 87,000 passengers daily. This shortfall, combined with high depreciation charges and interest costs, led to Taiwan HSR Corporation accumulating substantial debt. Without diving too deep into accounting rules, the financial strain was largely due to the depreciation method used in this BOT scheme, which placed a heavy burden on Taiwan HSR Corporation's finances. The depreciation period was set to reflect the length of the BOT concession rather than the much longer lifespan of the infrastructure. This led to a heavy accounting of fixed costs for assets like rolling stock and infrastructure, significantly impacting total operating costs. It wasn't until the third year of operation that the company achieved an operational income, and it took 5 years to generate a modest net income. Despite these financial struggles, THSRC continued to grow operationally and had a significant impact on Taiwan's economy and the lives of its people. Recognizing the importance of the system, the Taiwanese government decided to step in and provide a bailout, injecting $951 million in public funds after reducing the operator's capital by 60%. This financial improvement plan boosted the government's stake from about 37% to 64%. Additionally, the government extended the rail concession from 35 to 70 years and terminated the company's build-operate transfer business model. Even after bailing out the Taiwan HSR Corporation, the government has remained committed to expanding and developing the system. In 2016, the line was extended by 9 kilometers to Nangang, further enhancing connectivity. Then, in 2020, the government greenlit a northern extension from Taipei to Yilan, which will reduce travel time to just 13 minutes. This 56.4-kilometer extension is expected to be operational by 2030. Additionally, in 2023, the government approved a 60.9-kilometer southern extension towards Pingtung, with completion and opening planned for 2029. If you enjoyed this deep dive into Taiwan's HSR, don't forget to hit that subscribe button. and join our growing community of railway enthusiasts. Also, consider becoming a member or supporting us on Patreon. Your support helps us keep bringing you fascinating stories from the railway industry. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.